running late, so I'll be very concise. The session will be very concise, I assure you that. So please welcome all members. I'll start from myself. I'm moderating this session. I'm Professor Arun Patil, currently Vice Chancellor President at IMIT University, Rajasthan. Before that, I was in Australia for the last 20 years. With me, we have today Dr. Pankaj Singh. Pankaj Singh is Director, NIMS, NIMS University, very close, our neighbor. Then Professor V.S. Rao, President, NIIT University, Nimrana. We have also Dr. Sumer Singh. Sumer Singh ji is President, Vice Chancellor, Career Point University. We have also Dr. Pankaj ji Gupta, President, IIHMR. I think we are missing with Professor H.N. Verma. And also G.N. Saxena. So two members are not here. They must be hungry, I think. But anyway, let's start. So the title of the session is World-Class Institutions, Transforming Rajasthan as the Hub of Higher and Technical Education. I think it's very relevant to what we are doing today and tomorrow, the conclave. So when it comes to transformation, we need to think what sort of transformation we need. So as a moderator, I have liberty to control the session. I have liberty to control the speakers as well. So what I will do, I will just ask specific questions, okay? So, and stick with those responses. So let us start with all of you representing your own institutions. We need to know one or two good examples where transformation have been happened. For example, with IMIT, I can tell you a few examples where the curricula has been redesigned. We have introduced constructive alignment concept, which is very common these days in outcomes-based education. And we have strengthened our industrial connections, industry connections. So when it comes for the university's transformation, there are three important pillars. One is transformation in terms of teaching and learning. And we all are talking about digital learning these days. You must be agree with me. Then transformation in terms of research, because universities without research cannot be recognized, correct? So we need to also think of transformation in research. And third important pillar or aspect is engagement. And engagement is not necessarily local engagement. It's a regional, local, industry, international. Everything can come into that particular thing. So I would request each panel member, just start with Pankaj Singh ji. Maybe give one or two examples at the most where you can say that my university, the university NIMS, for example, this is what we are doing something differently. Because what we are talking here is we want to transform the higher education in Rajasthan so that it will be hub for technical education. And let us stick with technical education. Why, you know, yes, so one of the panelists, Professor Varmaji, is just joining us, Vice Chancellor Jaipur National University. Please welcome. So give one example from NIMS, there where you can see that that is your key aspect of transformation and why it should be called as a hub, or why it can be contributed to the hub for technical education. Thank you.
So thank you very much for inviting me for this eminent event. Myself, Dr. Pankaj Singh. I am one of the directors in NIMS University. And I'll give you a very brief background. I'm a neurosurgeon by profession. I did my graduation from KGMC, Lucknow, then post-graduation, and then did my super specialization in neurosurgery from UK. And I came here around 3 years back. So I stayed in UK for, say, a good 15, 16 years. NIMS University is one of the very first medical universities in India. And that is one of the pioneer universities in Rajasthan as well. So there are three parameters which is given by the moderator to me. One of the most important parameter is how we are making the impact on the human lives. So the making the impact on the human lives, NIMS University is creating an example right from its inception. There is no hospital nearby, say around 40 miles radius as compared to the NIMS University. It is a tertiary level, state-of-the-art hospital where we can provide all kind of medical services to the nearby community. So that is the one thing which we are doing very well and which we wish to continue doing. We are providing services like liver transplant, kidney transplant, neurosurgery, spine surgery, and to say the few. The second aspect of the discussion is research. Research, I would say, is the heart of NIMS University. We've been publishing papers and we've been involved in continuous research right from the beginning again. We have got a complete system, complete ecosystem for fostering the research and as well as creating new researchers, budding innovators, and budding entrepreneurs. We have got a system where all the new students, they are enrolled to a research lab, and that lab takes care of all the innovators who have comes with new ideas, and there is an idea bank that fosters the ideas, which basically we find that they can be sustainable ideas. Now there are a number of different areas where the research is being conducted, and that reflects in the number of publications which we publish every year, and that is being growing exponentially. And the third aspect of that was the employability and how we are helping society. NIMS University employs around, we have got 3,000 plus employees as working on campus. And then there are ancillary services that creates an employment in the society. So around 5,000 people, they are being employed. So this is the kind of the difference we are trying to create in society by putting the meaningful forces together. Thank you.
Thank you, Pankaj Singhji. So you mentioned a couple of examples where you're talking about medical education, if I'm not wrong. And we have one of the members, Pankaj Gupta, who is also president of IIHMR, okay, which is again delivering more into, you know, health medical programs. So maybe continuing with that, is there anything you can mention what you know, NIMS has been done, anything IIHMR doing very differently that we can say that it's a transformation of the whole institutions, whole institution has been happened in past few years. So when we are talking about, I think this, the agenda of this particular panel is how we can attract good students to Rajasthan, of course. How we can, because you know that the growth of higher education, the institutions, previously in the 80s, it was more focused in Maharashtra, Karnataka, and Tamil Nadu. And now suddenly, you know, the states, and now Rajasthan is one of the states having highest number of private universities. So why students should come here? Why students would give first priority or first preference to our institutions or our organizations? Only if we are different, only if we show that we are doing something very differently, the experience will be different. You know, the medical education, you know, right, and there is a lot of demand in medical education, same in technical education. So anything you can also mention, one or two examples at the most?
Thank you, appreciate. I'm from the IIHMR University, Jaipur, which is the top university in the area of healthcare, hospital, pharma, and rural management. So as professor was asking, you know, what new thing and what different thing we have been doing. So as you may be aware that IIHMR University has also been ranked as number one in India in the Swachhata ranking in the non-residential category. So how that happened that we did not use very big, you know, manpower or something, but we created an awareness that how it is important and how it is your own university and what kind of difference will it make. So it was not my goal, but it later became the goal of my team. Then it became the goal of all the Safai Karmchari. Then it became also the goal of my students. So they took a lot of ownership. And also we created a system of Shamdan, where the students said, okay, on one day we would like to give rest to the Safai wale bhaiya and didis, and we will clean the campus. So that is one thing, and also respecting the labor. Not like hum wo koode wale hain bhaiya aur hum safai wale bhaiya hain. Not like that. So that is one thing. So the dignity of labor, the power of belongingness, the power of co-owning the whole idea. So we created that, and it also resulted in our domain that we created that a model that a differentiating between what is a vidya and what is a avidya. What we know that sometimes you teach a lot of new things, maybe the big data, AI, blockchain, it's fine. But are you making them a good human being? And the courses on self-awareness and mindful leadership. So we created a center of wellness, mindfulness, and spirituality. And we created a system known as the IDP, Individual Development Plan. So we do a complete psychometric assessment, then we do a lot of, you know, discussion with them. And therefore, they know that what is the seed of possibility they carry within them. And then we create a model. And along with that, we give them many mentors. And also different type, you know, one is assistant manager level mentor, then vice president level mentor, and CEO level mentor. But creating that passion in them. And having program of Gan, Gyan, and Dhyan, doing the meditation, mindfulness, and a link in the right and left side of the brain. So they are becoming a much more aware people who are not only there just to pass time of 2 years, getting a good job and thank you very much. So making them aware that why you are here, and also organizing workshop like Who Am I workshops. So because many times we talk about innovation, but that is sometimes just a marginal improvement. Because the innovation only comes from a blank mind, like what you can say that you do not know, that you do not know. And from their domain, so it is a inquiry-based model and a human development-based model where our faculty, staff, they have been doing very well. So in this way, we have been doing many such initiatives. You asked me two initiatives, so I just shared only two, but I can share more.
Thank you. That's good. I think what, in a nutshell, what you mentioned is more for students, campus experience, students experience, and also value addition, you know, so about the human values
not the value education, but the being transformation.
Being transformation.
Because we mainly say that the do and have.
Yeah.
But we believe that not doing will not happen unless the being changes. Good. In order of any transformation, the self-transformation is very important.
Yes, yes.
Like we also have a program known as a teacher to guru program.
Good.
So from teacher to transform them to the gurus, and then they will do everything, whatever is needed.
And it is successful.
It is very, very successful. Well. Very well.
Good. So this is a good example. Now, I mentioned that one of the pillars of transformation in university system is also engagement and industry engagement. Professor Rao, you are coming from NIIT, University Neemrana. I can see Neemrana is a, you know, hub surrounded by so many industries. So is there anything you think you have done differently for NIIT, which in terms of industry engagement, in terms of strengthening industry, but most importantly, my and maybe audience interest would be how we use industry connections for our curricula. Okay, that is most important, because industry is coming to university campus and having tea, coffee and meeting. I don't think that is what we are aiming for, or we should aim for. So how we can go to the next level of industry engagement, where industry will talk about our curricula, we can ask industry what we can provide students and what sort of education we are providing. So can you give one or two examples? So
thank you, Dr. Arun.
Thank you.
Actually, transformation is possible only through innovation. I was with BITS Pilani for 44 years before joining NIIT University in 2016, and NIIT University is in a way replica of BITS Pilani, where deep industry engagement is one of the core principle of BITS Pilani, and the same thing has been adopted at NIIT University, be it curriculum development, or be it student engagement, or be it faculty development, or even be it campus design. innovation, innovation, innovation is the main thing. So one of the main innovations is this deep industry engagement. Under this, industry experts are involved not only in the curriculum design, but also in the delivery of courses. To the extent of 20%, our faculty come from the industry. Then there are internships, like any other university. Most important is the six-month industry practice, like BITS Pilani Practice School. Actually, BITS Pilani Practice School opened the window to the deep industry engagement for BITS Pilani. In a similar way, this university, right from inception, has implemented this 6 months industry practice as a compulsory course with a 20 credits. And it is evaluated by a faculty who is resident at the industry. So you mentioned, we are all NIIT surrounded by a big industrial area, but our students go for this 6 month industry practice to Bangalore, Pune, and NCR, Calcutta, and various other cities. And our resident faculty's role there is to ensure that this student is regularly present and having interactions with a person or an expert from the industry under whom he is supposed to work on a real life project. When I say industry practice, it is not that industrial training. Actually, a project is identified a priori before the student goes to the industry, and this project is of interest to that industry and to a person in that industry, and that person defines the project, and what type of student profile is required to work on that project is sent to us. So we identify. Now, for example, for all those students who have to go in January, already the project allotment has been done. Not only the organization, he has been told about the project and the requirements, whether he should know Python or he should know R programming or Hadoop or whatever it is. And then when the student is on the training, the faculty from the university, two faculty from the university using technology, they continuously monitor. It not only helps the students, it is also exposing our faculty to the latest technologies. Further, there is a faculty workshop every Saturday wherein our NIIT chairman, Mr. Pawar, and Mr. Thadani, they participate. And these students from various organizations, they share their experiences. And it is a 20-unit credit course. It is graded, and the grade goes into their transcript and counted in their CGPA. Apart from this, now we are doing something of bringing the industry into the classroom by taking small, small assignments and giving it to the students. One partner here is ST Microelectronics. So ST Microelectronics gives projects, and if there is a mathematics part that has to be done, it will be given. In a similar way, in a cybersecurity or in a data science, if there is a statistics particular part, and that will be given as a home assignment. So these are some of the industry engagement of NIIT University, which is essentially helping for employability.
So I asked you right question, I think, about industry engagement, because I knew that this is one of the thing which we all are talking about, giving students some exposure to industry. But two examples where you mentioned about BITS model and then using that 6 months compulsory training, but very differently, as well as bringing industry to classroom. So these are good examples. So with this, we nurture students, graduates, and then we talk about career. So the name of your university is Career Points. So the question I'm asking, is it really university focusing on student careers or okay? And maybe we need to know about one or two best examples, how you do that.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. See, first let me share the background of Career Point. Career Point initiative was by one of the IIT and Mr. Pramod Maheshwari. He is IIT Delhi pass out. And I think Bansal and the Career Point, they were the first classes started for IIT JEE. and he is the practitioner of new things always. Let me share with you all that since last year, in case of coaching also, he has come up with Career Point 2.0. And that 2.0 is thinking for coaching back at home of the student, not in quota. So this is how everywhere, and then he diversified his group into universities. We don't have university in quota, but we have university in Hamirpur, Himachal Pradesh also. We don't only have the coaching universities, but we have the residential school. So always he looks for newer things at the affordable cost and how it can reach up to the last corner or maybe the student from the poor family also. And the same was the, what I should say, the vision behind this university. But one good thing which I would like to mention, Professor Rao has also mentioned that yes, BITS model is also a unique model and many of the universities are following it. Similar way, we have followed the IIT model where focus is on processes and systems. Not only that much, only the US universities are having option of major and minor degrees, option of open courses that any disciplined guy can go for maybe some engineering course or science course or any other management course. So all those options are there. And same way we are designing our course curriculum as per the requirement of industry. So every year we have one or the other inclusion. This is the first point. Secondly, how we engage the students. The first day itself, once the student takes the admission, our mentoring program takes care of his SWOT analysis and then taking him or her up to the last stage, whether 3-year program or the 4-year program, in all respects, whether it's a personal issue or professional issue. So that is one unique thing we are following. Second thing, again, it's a project work. Maybe many times it is given in the 3rd year or 4th year in case of engineering. But we are starting from the 1st year itself, not only for engineering student, for every student. And nowadays, we are promoting interdisciplinary projects. And this is a full credit course. And every semester, a group of students, they have to take up a project. And you'll not believe, last year, our physiotherapy students, engineering students. Then again, agriculture students, computer science students. And they have done the projects on remote sensing and many other newer areas. So that's another thing. Every semester has the project and every student has to be involved in those projects. And the third one is, yes, that has been taken from BITS system, the practice school, going since beginning. So like NIT, we also have the full semester internship program, especially for our engineering students. The other things are, yes, since morning I'm listening about skills more, knowledge less, whether this was the address of Honorable Chief Minister or the ministers, or even I could go through the presentations of Adobe or maybe payment, along with the learning management system. So our focus is again on systems and the processes. No one becomes a great institution in one day. Our belief is that yes, as a new university, as 5 years, 7 years old university, let us have the processes and systems and let us improve them continuously. That is the way out. Otherwise, I think we have not seen any institution. Nowadays, we are talking about many of the universities being run by corporate houses, whether it's by Munjal or even other. So if we see, they are running on different model, but today we are looking forward for scalability also, once we are large number of the students. So all these things are the key things. Lastly, if you give me a few seconds, I would like to sum up with that as of now, in majority, every institution is focusing on knowing, the knowledge part. But the key is doing and being. So I think this is where the engagement, right engagement is required. And doing is through projects, doing is through out of the classroom. And being is somewhere if we can inculcate values, not only values, but somebody, maybe Dr. Karthik was mentioning about the communication skills, especially about the English speaking skill, and that is true in Rajasthan. Yes, I belong to Rajasthan, a small village. And at one stage in NCR, one of my chairman was saying, don't recruit any faculty from Rajasthan. And the issue was only English communication. So with all these things, thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sumer Singh ji. It was great. I have one query. So you said one of the key aspects you mentioned about projects and introducing projects from first year, correct?
First year.
So is it completely project-based learning or are you just doing blended?
Just mode? We are ensuring that whatever they listen in the classroom, maybe in a smaller form, let the project be minor, depending upon the nature of the program, but let it be hands-on working and the team working. Yeah. So
suppose there is a BTech student.
Yeah.
Okay. So what you are saying that right from year one, first year, maybe first semester, second semester, there is a component of project, correct? Has it been credited? The credits are included?
Yes.
Has it been assessed?
Yes.
It has marked?
It has been assessed. It has been marked. Mm-hmm. And even they are being given, the awards also, okay. Maybe department-wise, school-wise, at university.
So how do you decide? Suppose, for example, there are 200 credits.
Yes.
Okay. So out of that, the first year credits, component of 200 credits to first year, how many credits and what, suppose first year is a common for ETEC.
Yes.
So what sort of projects they have to do, how you decide, depends on their interest or you force them to do projects?
We decide on the basis of their interest. Mm. Say in first year there are common classes, yeah, for mechanical, computer science, electrical, all the branches. Mm. So even they make their groups. And they take up, maybe they do certain projects at the school level also, 12th level also. Mm. But they raise the level. They raise the level according to the subject which are taught to them. They learn from the seniors. And then even at times, the same project they build up in the next semester, okay, and even the next year also. Mm.
Okay, they can go and final year is still team project or
no,
solo
final year
project?
Is a project.
But it's an individual project or team project?
No, that's an individual project. That's good.
So, thank you very much. We have also Professor H.N. Varmaji, Vice Chancellor, Jaipur National University. When we are talking about transformation, would like to hear from you. Actually, I heard you off the record also. One or two good examples where we can say that, you know, this is transformation.
So, I am H.N. Varma, Vice Chancellor, Jaipur National University. I think all of you know about this. I think all of you know about this university. This is one of the universities which came into existence as one of the first private university. And now in last 12 years, it has grown into a multidisciplinary university. And you just name any technical or professional program, we will have it at our university. So that is the greatest advantage, and that gives a very improved quality teaching to the students. Right from the very beginning, when we start screening students for admissions, we are very careful and we admit the students, and then after the admission of the students, the first thing is the induction program, where we tell them about the various activities of the university and that this program continues for a couple of days or even for a week. And we make the students feel quite at home during this period so that they, when they come from far off places, they feel very comfortable when they come to our university. This, as you all know, this is a highly competitive world, and if you have to survive, particularly in case of private sector, you have to give something additional to the students, and that is what we are doing. And right from the very beginning, we have great focus on the quality teaching, and the major focus is on the hands-on training to the students. And for the hands-on training to the students, we have very good labs, and wherever we don't have the facilities, we send them to the various institutions for the better training. We invite the various senior faculty members from premier institutions, and then we also frequently arrange the workshops on the different areas so that the students are exposed to the latest technologies. And recently we have introduced all the major new technologies, perhaps particularly in our computer science programs and in our electronics program, so that the students are well versed with the latest developments in the various fields. Then in the agriculture, what we started about 4 years back, we have the labs which are perhaps one of the best labs. And then we have greater focus on the field experiments, which are supposed to be the backbone of any agriculture program. So these are some of the advantages. And then being a multidisciplinary university, the quality teaching we can maintain. For example, I tell you, if we are having B.Tech biotechnology program, then the subjects of the chemical engineering, they are being taught by the experts in the chemical engineering program. And similarly, in the computer science, we have the experts from the computer science program. So that gives a very broad-based information to the students who are taking admission in our various programs. And recently, we have started several startups also, and where the students, they take up their projects, they execute their projects, and if they need any guidance, we have tied up with the various industries also. Recently, we had one major conclave on the various issues, health issues of the Rajasthan, where we had the participation from several senior consultants, senior doctors from AIIMS, various AIIMS institutes in India. Then we had the industry academia interaction also, where we had about 40 industries who participated. Then we have recently started only 1 year back a chapter from the National Academy of Sciences India, which is called as Rajasthan Jaipur chapter, where we are having several programs related to the uplifting of the students' career. It is providing knowledge, updated knowledge to the students. And then we are taking these programs to the masses also to make them aware what are their requirements. For example, one of the projects which they have sanctioned to us to improve the nutritional status of the scheduled tribe women. So we are actively engaged that also. And so many other societal activities which are required for the betterment of the students.
So Verma sir, enough examples, plenty of examples. I think you covered almost everything. Sahasrabuddhi sir is here, chairman AICT also. So when we are talking about transformation and trying to make Rajasthan state as a hub of higher and technical education, and some of the examples we shared, that most of the common examples when we talk about the internships, looking for employability, enhancing student experience. But as I said initially, teaching learning reforms are most important. And when it comes to transformation, we talk about digital learning, resources are key things. So when we talk about flipped classrooms, we talk about PBL, you know, whether it is a project-based learning or whether it's a problem-based learning. So the question I extended to you right from, you know, projects from first year. So I was involved in designing of this such curricula in Australia. Believe me, it is not easy. Okay. And most importantly, suppose you have 200 students in the final year and say 200 students in first year. So many projects, and every time making sure those projects will be assessed in a proper way. My observation, we start many things, we try to do many things, we try to implement many things, but when it comes to closing the loop and designing assessments, I'm not sure that we are doing it perfectly, because if you don't assess properly, as we know, assessment drives learning. So students are more encouraged because they are more interested in their assessments and marks rather than what we do. And then if there is a hands-on connected with those assessments, they enjoy. So I think when we give these experiences, each university, we are very competitive, we compete with each other, but we need to think that how best our teaching learning reforms will help students to enhance their experience, Then we talk about employability, then we talk about students job ready. Again, there is this, you know, some serious data we are talking about in terms of engineering graduates or in terms of technical graduates and so on. But some of the examples which, you know, you are following BITS model, 6 months internships, are very good. But again, if you want to stand out in, you know, these 100, 200 universities competing with each other, or maybe 50, 60 universities competing regionally, you need to really make sure that something we have or I have, which will tell student and parents that, yes, I should go to this university. Because parents are smart, students are smarter, they do a lot of search, they do a lot of background, collect a lot of background information. And once they come with a lot of, you know, perception and expectation, and then they see that, okay, you know, blended learning, nothing is happening, flipped classroom, nothing is happening, and they said it's a damn boring classroom teaching, and more, you know, focused on theory and so on. It doesn't work. Industry also, if you give exposure to students right from year one, when they see somebody from industry coming and talking to them, talking about the innovations, talking about what is happening in industry. But most importantly, I think we should talk to industry and we should ask them how we should design our curricula, because they are the one going to employ our graduates. So I think this is not many times we are doing, but this is something which I think is a need. We should ask industry, this is our curricula, this is how our BTech mechanical program, you tell us what we should have and what we should not have. So I think more engagement of industry in a proper way is most importantly important. And campus experience, you know, students staying, we are still talking about campuses, we are still talking about face-to-face teaching. We are not fully gone to, you know, fully digitized or fully online or fully distance mode, especially in technical education. We cannot go, it's not easy to go in fully distance mode. But some diplomas, some associate degrees, yes, that can be done, provided there is some minimum contact hours students would be visiting campus and so on. So campus experience is also important for students, and you can see that students, parents, when my experience, when they come to enroll, they first ask about cafeteria, they first ask about the quality of food, they first ask about gym and sports facilities, and obvious, because they are paying for these facilities and they want to make sure that it should be done. Other thing which is missing in our Indian context, the technical education, which is very important, student feedback. I'm not sure, I'm very passionate about asking students, very passionate about taking students' feedback. Even for this forum, there is not a single student here. And we are designing something for students, we are talking about student experiences, we are talking about transformation, and there is no single student we can ask for. So I think student engagement is most important, and getting proper feedback from students. So in many countries, Western countries, where funding is directly related to student experience. For example, again, I come from Australia, spending 20 years. So there was a model, each university has an online student feedback model, and the data goes directly to the government. And based on the student feedback data, the universities are funded for next year. So if your feedback is poor this year, there is a standard formula, that percentage will be reduced from the government funding. Okay, I'm talking about public universities, and there are only one or two private universities. So that thing we are not taking serious. So we still have paper-based feedback. There are some universities implementing online feedback. But what we do after that, we collect student feedback, and what we do after that, what is called a closing the loop. And that is where, you know, missing a lot in many universities, because I think we are not listening to students. We are just asking them to say something, but we are not seriously listening to students. And I'm not saying we means, I'm not generalizing it, but we need to really take it very seriously. And then, you know, their experience is enhanced, their learning, is enhanced, and teaching learning, we are doing that, blended mode, whether we are using a lot of technologies, research we have spoken about, in medical institutions where definitely research is well done. I would say that, you know, the research in medical institutions is far, far better, you know. 50% revenue from research, because it is well done. And it is possible, because you cannot even survive without research in medical field. So there are a lot of good examples we have received, right from campus experience to, I like mentoring programs. So students are at MIT, we have also mentoring, but also again the mentoring gives a lot of avenues for students to be engaged, and you can identify students at early stages, the students at risk, what we call. You know, in technical or in education, what happens? You know, students come to third year and fourth year, and they, you know, after that, you know, simply a gap and nothing happens. And by the time we start approaching students, it is too late. So better to, you know, identify these students at risk in the early stages, and that can be possible with mentorship or mentor-mentee program. The multidisciplinary approach I like, because nowadays, biotechnology cannot work in isolation without engineering help from engineering students or help from engineering professions, because all professions are now multidisciplinary professions. So I think you have advantage over that. So with this note, I think it's time to stop. Thank you very much for all panel members for your contribution. Thank you, and all the best.